Hi, I'm Michelle Olivier, and you're listening to Hey, I Want Your Job, the podcast that looks at amazing jobs and what it takes to get them. Hey, and welcome to Hey, I Want Your Job. And today I have a guest whose job is freaking sweet, I'm not gonna lie, but that I have zero acumen to be able to do his job. So I kind of don't. Dave, what's your job?
Hey, Michelle, I'm Dave, everybody. And my job is currently a senior director of operations for AA Labs, which is a virtual world company.
Yeah. So what do you really do, Dave?
Well, I do a lot of things. It's a startup. It's kind of a startup. It's shifting its gears to kind of triple down in the new area. So it's very startup-like, and I do a lot of things. But the things include some project management, some product design, some art direction, some spelunking into some of the content itself to try to fix stuff when it's needed, some pitch work, some investor meetings.
We have so deeply buried the lead at this point. It is nothing but comical. Dave, what industry do you work in for all of this? There we go.
Games or games adjacent. Yep. Current job is not actually right in the middle in the pocket of games. It's a virtual worlds company. So it's not actually coming up with a game's title, which is going to be for sale as a game. But it's a virtual world, which is like a game. But it's not closed in terms of its universe or its economy or any of those sorts of things. So you'll be able to join or leave, and it's going to be more like a social space online that you can go to and visit, which is maybe think of it more of as a successor to something like a Second Life.
I was gonna say this sounds very Second Life-y. Is that what we're doing here? Okay.
It's gonna be a little different. Its focus is a little more accessible than Second Life was.
Okay.
It's also, you could think Roblox too. Obviously everybody wants to be like Roblox now, but it's similar in the sense that it's a place that a lot of people can go show up and there's events there, there's brands there, there's a lot of things to do and a lot of fun to have.
That's amazing. So what kind of things, so let's start. So Second Life, obviously uber famous for being Second Life, spawning 8,000,
businesses, real estate. Yeah.
Real estate. But then also even people who don't know what Second Life is know what Second Life is because it's been in movies and everything else, obviously not called Second Life, but basically, anytime in a film, somebody was living in their virtual reality, something, or like an episode of, I think there's an episode even of like CSI or something, or there's a plot around it. I think the Wikipedia page of like instances of like note for a Second Life is pretty impressive. So that's what Second Life is for anybody who doesn't know, but it is like uber famous as somewhere that is one of the first virtual times that I can think of that there was a virtual world like you're talking about where people made non-virtual money. Like there were not a small number of people who made an actual world living.
They did.
Making, doing, selling things for and in the virtual world. Now we know that that happens all the time with mining operations for stuff like WoW and all kinds of things like that. But Second Life, as far as I know, and you know more about the history of this kind of stuff than I do probably, that's the first instance I know of where that really happened.
And gold farming probably was like, those are the primordial days, right? Gold farming, then you could... Because then if you're on WoW, you create an account, you like level up your character to the max it out, and then you sell it on eBay or whatever was the trend, right? Yeah. You could sell your character online for thousands of dollars. Yeah. People would buy it, so they could skip all that time. Those are the early days, man. Totally. But Second Life was very experimental and I think super successful. And Linden Labs, which is the creators of it, they're just amazing. So they did a lot.
So you guys are working on a similar kind of project to that. So is that like, is the goal at the outset that people will absolutely have a real world economy within the virtual existence?
Eventually, yes. So we're starting out, the AA Labs is founded by an amazing woman, Amber Allen. And she's ex-Riot and Warner Brothers, ex-Warner Brothers Interactive. She's like a sort of like a ball of flame. She just comes through the room and it's like, it completely like just dominates all the attention and then is gone, you know, like in a poof, right? But she's awesome. She's amazing. Her background is in events, like in terms of the company's history, it's in physical events with a digital lens. So the company has done a ton of work in very bespoke, like launch events or brand events, like Ready Player One or Mr. Mercedes, or huge events that ended up generating tons of impressions and are stories that are continuing to be talked about. As super memorable, right? And so what COVID did for them is kind of flip them from, say, a 70% physical to 30% digital, because there was always a digital aspect, technology aspect, everything they did, holograms or you know, projected imagery or you know, all kinds of fun light shows, laser shows, those sorts of things. And now it's at least in COVID, it's been pushing the digital side more.
Okay.
And so a lot of it was events-based, and it still is heavily events-based, but they're thinking much longer term about what it could become. So it's still kind of got a lot of traction in the event space. And the first and second generation of tech has been heavily in the event space, and it's done really well. Tremendous traction, which is why I was excited to join, because I was like, how is this even possible? This is nuts. And it's just amazing to watch how successful the company has been able to be so far. What they're building now is really sort of, you know, now that they've seen all of the opportunities, and everyone's talking about the metaverse, of course, now, there's a pragmatism to the selection of markets that is at AA Labs, which is really unique. And so it's going to be starting out with a little more focus on business and then business to business to consumer. So ultimately B2B to C, say.
Okay, that makes sense.
So it needs to be consumer friendly, because that's ultimately the end user. But we're basically creating a platform that a lot of other companies can use and leverage.
Well, that sounds very exciting and very interesting. But that's not really what I wanted to talk to you about today, as you know. I really want to talk to you about what you've done to get you to this point and what's come before. So before this, I know, and you know, some of your background in gaming. So just for people who don't know you like I know you, give us some of the titles that you've worked on that they may have heard of.
Sure. So I have a unique... very wandering road as a career. So I'll just start out with that. I started out in 1997.
We're old.
at DreamWorks Interactive in Los Angeles. A friend of mine from high school and college joined DreamWorks because of a interactive game that we had made at an art school, you know, the art, Academy of Art University in San Francisco. And a recruiter was there, and we were just lucked out. We had ours on display, like on a projection display back then. You know, it's a big thing to have your work on the wall and stuff. So our game was projected on a wall, and we had a few recruiters that we didn't expect to actually show up. We were trying to win a competition where we would have won like an SGI machine. And back then you could sell an SGI machine for maybe $15,000, and maybe you could pay off some of your student loans, you know? So we were trying really hard to win that SGI machine. We got second place, but we got jobs at DreamWorks instead.
Even better.
So we had this tough decision to make, which was finish school, because we were close. I think we were like, I was one semester away from graduating, or take the job. And I was just like, man, you know, like, isn't this what I would want, having graduated, to actually have in my hand? I already have it. So can I just come back if this doesn't work out? Can I just come back and finish? And I just decided to take the plunge. And so actually, and he did too. So we moved from San Francisco to Los Angeles, and then that's all. That's that. That was the beginning.
Then from there, where does it take you?
So yeah, so I started working on licensed titles at DreamWorks Interactive for movies. So it's like games like Small Soldiers, The Lost World. Lost World was my first game to work on for the PlayStation 1, right?
Wow.
So
yeah, 3-year-old.
We are old. And super old. But jumped from there to, you know, the team that I was with was an amazing team, amazing producers from, you know, a lot of them were ex-Disney. They jumped over to DreamWorks and to help start DreamWorks. And we started, Steven Spielberg had just finished filming Saving Private Ryan and was coming by the studio and saying, hey, you know, I've been playing, well, between shoots, been playing this game called GoldenEye. And it's totally awesome. And I think we should make a game set in World War II that's basically GoldenEye. And so that's where Medal of Honor was born. And so I worked on, I think, three. I have credits on Medal of Honor, Medal of Honor Underground, and Medal of Honor Frontline. And then that spawned, there was a kind of a business moment where the team, you know, EA had purchased the studio, and the culture was starting to change. And so, and a lot of the team members were kind of growing. And after, I think we had worked together for about 5 years, some of us just decided, what would it be like to kind of go out on our own and start our own shop? And so a big portion of that Medal of Honor team ended up at a company called Spark Unlimited, which was also in Los Angeles, and began work. We signed a deal with Activision to begin Call of Duty, but ended up becoming Call of Duty, right? The group that I was in was at Spark were sort of a sister, kind of a, I want to call it a sister studio, but we're working on the same brand new franchise with Infinity Ward, which had just come over from ex 2015 people. And amazing at gameplay and layout, like just the best, right? They still are, right? And moved on to Respawn and still are, right? They're the best. And we were more, I think our strengths were more in branding and story, probably narrative at the time. One of the things that the Spark team did was focus on how to differentiate Call of Duty as a brand and as a franchise from Medal of Honor, because there was some litigation and stuff back then. And so need to make sure it was distinctive. But that team went on and we shipped Call of Duty Finest Hour, which was the first game for console and the most, I think, financially successful game in the franchise until Modern Warfare.
I have to say, not that any of them have really suffered. Like, I mean, Call of Duty is...
It's pretty... like baseball now, right? Yeah. I mean, it's just as American as baseball almost, I would say. At least for the game, at least for our generation.
My brother-in-law's genuine, like, career goal is to be a Twitch streamer for Call of Duty. I have no words. He has literally come to me for career advice. I'm like, I have none. Maybe get a career. Like, this isn't a thing. If you want to stream, please, like, on Twitch, you playing Call of Duty, go nuts, my friend. But you can't plan that that's going to somehow pay you. I get that some people get paid. You can't plan it. Like, you can hope, but you can't plan. So, anyway, yes. So, carry on. So, then Call of Duty, and then...
Yep, Call of Duty. We shipped a couple more games while I was there for PlayStation. This is PS2 days, I think, still. I had a girlfriend and met her at church, and she became my fiance. We got married, I think, in 2001 and started having children pretty quickly. And by 2007, we had three kids and one on the way. We started to ask ourselves, you know,
what were we thinking?
We were getting funny looks at the grocery store in Los Angeles, right? Because we had three little babies in diapers and she was pregnant, and people would look at us like, who are these people? What are they doing here? They're totally weird. So we started to feel like maybe, you know, it was really expensive too, right? So we're trying to think about what do we want to do? You know, where do we want to be? And we knew we wanted, you know, from a life choice standpoint, we wanted a place to have kids where they could go to school and have a great education and be safe and all of that. And so we ended up moving to Austin, 2007, late 2007. And I ended up moving from Spark Unlimited to Midway and working on a game called that didn't end up releasing because of what happened with Midway, but it was called Criminal. And it was an open world game, kind of in the vein of multi-action genre titles like GTA. Okay. So, but from there, I mean, in terms of role, just really briefly, I started at DreamWorks as an environment artist, and then became a senior and a lead artist while at EA, after EA had purchased the studio. So I was a lead environment artist at that point. And at Spark, I was a kind of corporate secretary for the company. I helped, we co-founded it. Like a lot of the decision-making was done in my living room, you know, around what we're gonna do. Drove the truck with all the chairs in it to the, you know, our startup location, all that stuff. It was a big ritual. We ended up renting out this awful, we co-leased or sublet a building, a space on Wilshire Boulevard where we first started out. And it was like a trailer park sales office or something like that. And the team together spent an entire day just cleaning it. Cause there was like so much nicotine. You could take a picture frame off the wall and that you could see
the yellow.
Yeah. So, and we would blow the circuits in that space on a daily basis. Cause we had so many computers in there. It was not set up. Wasn't set up for a game development shop. But we ended up moving into Sherman Oaks not too long after that. But while I was at Spark, I went from kind of an environment art focus to a technical art focus because we were short staffed and the team needed tools. And so I just learned how to write in Mel and Python and wrote the suites of tools that the team used on the environment team. And became essentially a technical artist or did technical artwork as a lead. And also learned because we're under some, you know, running a business is different than being on a team. So learning a lot about running the business. A corporate secretary gave me exposure to a lot of the business development work that we needed to do. And getting smarter about business and how to save money was essential to staying alive. And yeah, so that drove me into understanding project management and product development more. And that's where I started to build new muscles there. And that's where I learned it. From there, I jumped. I mean, that's kind of the inception point from what has been sort of a double track path for my career since then. So I kind of jumped back and forth between, more operational or business related roles, or production roles or EP roles, back to content roles. And that's just been a pattern that's repeated over the years.
So in your heart, when you kind of think about who you are as a professional, what do you think of yourself as an artist? Do you think of yourself as a businessman who happens to make money in games? Do you think of yourself as a creative director that brings multiple creative visions together? Like, what do you think of yourself as after all this?
I think what I've evolved it to become, and I don't know that it's an end state at all, but working with amazing teams has transformed me as a person. And it started at DreamWorks, honestly, like probably that first job. In fact, we were introduced because you were helping me with some personal resume work, right? And yeah. Doing that work, there was a lot of questions that y'all made me think a long time about, took me extra time to answer all the questions. But in just thinking about it, it was extremely impactful to me to be around the people that I was around those first 2 years at DreamWorks. There was, I mean, just tremendous thought leadership at that studio. And I was brand new baby coming into the industry. And I think since then, it's been really wanting to be around just amazing talent, amazing brilliance all the time. And so for me, when I think about me, I like to build teams in creative enterprises. So that's a macro level. That's what I like to do. So if it's It's say we're going to make a game, or we're going to build a studio. We're going to build a studio to make games. I just came from Kabam Austin. I was brought in as one of the kind of the foundational hires to help build a team and make a couple games and make some technology, some cutting edge technology. And for me, that was exciting because you don't get that many opportunities to build teams in your life. I've done that. That was probably my third real time doing that, maybe fourth real time doing that. And you always want to try to build on your last attempt because it's never perfect and it's always super hard. And the culture is its own animal, and the people that you bring in are going to end up affecting what it ends up becoming. And so, it's always very exciting and unique to be a part of, kind of the foundational level of.
So it's really about the growing
together as a team.
Okay.
Yeah. And being around amazing talent. Those are like the number, probably those are just two things that I'm always gravitated toward. Yeah.
So you've got over 20 years in the gaming industry.
Yep.
Do you still like video games?
I do.
What do you play?
So I was super hooked on Genshin Impact for many, many, many months, through probably, when did I put it down? I think I put it down in February. Regrettably, because I'd still totally be playing it. I decided to play it on my PS4. But I started playing it because I love Breath of the Wild on Switch. Love Breath of the Wild. And I was like, okay, here's this knockoff. I'm just going to play it so I can bash on it, like secretly, right? So I started playing, and it was free to play. And I was working for Kabam, and Kabam was my first free to play exposure to working on a free to play title. And gotcha. So I wanted to understand more. And a part of my job is to make sure that I definitely understand all the ways that games can monetize and how you change the systems design and the meta so that you can monetize a free-to-play game. And so part of my research was forcing myself to play this game called Genshin Impact. But I got to say, man, they did a freaking amazing job. And I didn't want to, like, I was begrudgingly admitting, like, okay, they did some things right. And then, like, after maybe a month of being totally addicted to it, I was like, all right, they totally did a kick-ass job. I have to totally give them props. They took what was already an amazing sandbox and meta experience in Breath of the Wild, and they totally converted it to free-to-play. And I looked up the production history on that game. I think they did it in under 3 years. And it was just astounding to me. Like, that they, I still don't even know how they did it. Like, it must have just been a death march for three years. There isn't that much available because it's a Chinese company. Mm-hmm. The Chinese developer that did it, so their info is a little sparse on how it was built. But I mean, it's a Unity game. It's like, how they, like, I have so many questions about how it was even made. I would love to be able to interview folks that were on the team.
Do you need me to do like some investigation, please, and find it? I got it. I'm on it.
That would be amazing.
I have connections. I know people who know people, Dave.
Yeah. So I did set that one down. Yeah. We went through some rocky times at Kabam recently, which you're aware of. And I think that the Austin studio ended up kind of shifting its focus to supporting Vancouver, some initiatives and games in Vancouver. And I ended up deciding to depart. And so I stopped playing games in that little window. But for some reason, I kept playing Dead Cells on my phone on the Switch. I love Castlevania is one of my original first loves in gaming.
And it's so, one of my husband's biggest loves. Yeah.
So I started playing, I don't know why, but I was playing Dead Cells and I was like, you know, I need to go back and play like a couple of the Castlevania games. So that's what I've been doing lately, is Symphony of the Night.
Well, I will have to tell him to try Dead Cells then, because like I said, Castlevania is his favorite. But I don't
Dead
know if
Cells is amazing. I mean, I can't. Dead Cells is the best game.
He's a retro gaming nerd, so we have every video game console ever made.
Awesome.
Is it, Dave?
It is totally awesome.
Including every handheld, including apparently there was one that came out that was like a mobile phone, but it was also like a gaming console. We have two of those. He accidentally won two eBay auctions on that one. Like, anytime you need to come over and nerd with my husband about his extensive video game collection, by all means, if you want to take a couple consoles with you when you go, you also have my permission to do that, Dave.
Don't tease me.
Oh, that my sweet awesome. But so when I say like he's a Castlevania fan, I mean like he has taught the 3-year-old He's like, hey, oh, and he is currently creating his own video game starring our children. That's like totally 8-bit to be played on like the original Game Boy. So hey, I will, I will have him send you the link. I think you will find it amusing, if nothing else, to see it. So yeah, I love that you are a gamer. We play different games. I don't do first person shooters. I don't do platforms. I'm very picky. Like the pickiest bitch ever about my video games.
What's your favorite? What's your go-to then?
Oh.
Picky, because it has to be awesome then. Which one is it?
So my favorite game of truly all time is Fable.
Okay.
I love it so much. And I love it so much that I totally like fangirl stalked Peter Molyneux. Love Fable. But then obviously you can only play because it's a finite game. So once you've caught them all, you can only play it so many times. Like every once in a while, I'll go back to it every couple of years and be like, I'm gonna replay this because I still love it. After Fable, close second, Diablo. Yes. Total Diablo girl. Love it.
I haven't played Fable, so I can't comment on Fable, but yeah, it sounds like I need to check it out.
So do you know the premise of Fable?
No, I don't. I've only seen like videos and stuff.
So it is, it's basically an RPG. So you pick a class, etc., and you have like RPG kind of overall save the world kind of quest that you're on. And then there's obviously like a million side quests to that you can choose to do or not. But as you go through, you have not only do you level up your normal like agility and that kind of shit, but you also make choices that are moral choices. And your moral choices affect the way that other people see you, including in how they interact with you, but also how they physically see you after a period. So for example, if you eat a bunch of pie to get your health back up, you get fat. If you eat celery, you lose weight and you get thinner. If the villager has a present that you need or a thing that you need, you can choose to kill the villager and take it, at which point your evil quotient goes up. Or you can choose to get the villager drunk and like do a dance for him, at which point your nice guy quotient goes up. And like the way that you dress and the way that you present yourself impacts how people interact with you. So like if you want to get a great discount in the shops, you can either wear like a skimpy outfit with a corset, or you can wear like the evil like highway robber outfit, and like either they're enamored by you and give you the discount, or they're terrified of you and give you the discount, but either one. And then there's also opportunities to truly seduce characters within the game, like the AI within the game. And like if you don't choose to do that in a protected way, you can get STDs and you can make babies.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, it's fantastic. And there's interior design. So you can buy houses in all of like the cities, and then you get rent for your houses, but it depends on like the level of furnishing. So like if you have a shed that's like decorated like a shed, you get less rent than if you have it decorated really nicely. It's amazing. Wow. Very comprehensive. Yeah. That's well, because Molyneux, like he's the God game creator, right? Yeah. So like there's that element to it, but then he's also the tycoon guy. So Fable kind of brings both of those things together, and you get magic bullets. And like, I feel like there's no lose in that.
That's all. That sounds awesome.
I'm a big fan, obviously. But yeah, so I have very strict rules about playing Fable. I only ever make the really good choices, because if you're really, really good all the time, you have a halo. If you make bad choices, you get big horns, no horns, all halo.
That's kind of the way.
Yeah, I have very strict. My husband's like, why don't we be evil this time? I feel like that's why you don't get to play the game. You just get to watch. This is why you don't.
I might be superstitious, but I feel like it might affect me somehow. Like it'll rub off on me in some way, right?
Totally. So, what if this actually impacts my karma? What if being a dick in this video game counts as being a dick in life? Like, but I don't need that.
If I practice being a dick in the game, won't I be more? Doesn't it increase my probability of being a dick in real life? Right? Doesn't
absolutely.
It?
Absolutely.
I would think so. It's escape and everything, but like, I don't know.
And that my husband argues that actually it gives him a very safe place to be a jerk because everybody has those impulses, right?
He's an outlet.
He's like, so I can kick the puppy in the video game. You don't have to like kick actual puppies. I'm like, you're wanting to kick puppies. We should have other talks.
Yeah.
One of the things that struck me when you were talking about your current company that I think is very interesting and is kind of reminds me of a topic I want to switch us to is you were talking about your founder and how she's amazing. And then you started listing all of her credentials of amazingness, which were super impressive. As a woman who is a gamer, one of the things that I really hate after having been in the gaming community one way or the other for most of my life is that you don't get to show up female in gaming and not have to sit through some form of interrogation to quantify that, yes, in fact, you get to call yourself a gamer. And they'll be like, well, but have you heard of such and so iteration? And you hear the same thing in a lot of areas, like, you know, the classic one for a lot of my friends that are Trekkies, they're like, every con, they're like, oh, but do you know about in the third season when such and so happened? And they're like, that's a trick question that happened in the fourth season. And like, it's just ridiculous.
Yeah.
As a guy who is not a jerk to women in gaming, first of all, do you see it happening to us? And second of all, why do you think this is there? As somebody who's in the boy club.
So there's two lenses I can look at it from. One is like as a gamer, right?
Yeah.
And game culture. Then there's as a person that's worked in the game industry and what it's like inside of game development studios, right?
Yeah.
And I got to say, I haven't, and it might just be because I've been lucky the places I've been, and I'm, it's just, you know, treating people fairly and equally is something which is just normal to me. Like it's so, you know, my whole life, everywhere I've worked, the DreamWorks, EA, you know, the Spark, every place that I've worked, we've had what you call now an inclusive space, you know, like, and it was never like whenever we were going through hiring, like I've interviewed thousands of people, you know, in the last 20 years, always hungry for candidates that were not like the standard candidates, you know, and if there was a female candidate, they automatically got, you know, I just got to say like this my personal experience has been that if I have, you know, a lot of candidates to look at, because your inbox fills up when you put out a post and you work, especially if you're working for a studio that has a marquee name, your inbox fills up, and you want to spend. I spend extra time, probably. I mean, I spend a lot of time with every candidate, but I might spend extra time because there's a vanilla quality, not to make it too specific, of having the sameness of a culture. I don't think it's exclusive to gaming and, you know, the demographics of the game industry so much, but I think the sameness of any culture can start to feel vanilla if it's all the same thing all the time, right? So, so as a studio, in studios I've worked in, positions of leadership I've been in, you know, it's things like fair treatment and equal pay and discrimination have been things that a good leader is always, you know, keeping an eye on to make sure isn't happening. And I haven't been exposed to that happening a lot. And I actually can't think of hardly any cases that I've personally seen. Now, that doesn't mean it doesn't exist. It means that when I walk into the room, people have
everybody a shuts reaction. Up.
Yeah. They have a different reaction, right? Than if someone else who might be a target of some bad behavior walks into a room, right?
Right.
But I mean, you need to nip it in the bud as soon as it happens, regardless of whatever it's about, because that kind of behavior is just not tolerable, right? Now, game industry, but talking about as a gamer in the game culture, I think this is, all I can think of is that I have theories, because I grew up in a very secluded, like, I grew up on an island in the Puget Sound. There was nobody to talk. It was very boring. There was no, well, obviously pre-internet, it was very boring. You couldn't even get online, right? So, and it like cost money to call people on the phone back then. Cost money. Right. So like you got a bill. It's like the, it's like a power bill, basically, back then. The more you talk, the more you pay. So it was super boring. And my friends and I would play games. It was either like, in back in the day, it's like off the coast of Seattle. So either you're doing heroin or you're playing video games. Those are kind of your two choices. And so we played video games, you know.
Good choice. And good choice.
Yeah. I might because we were so isolated, but we, you know, and it was so early still for the game industry. We were playing games that were kind of pre sort of the M-rated stuff, like before the rating systems. When the mm-hmm. games were all very like Nintendo-like, you know, they're playful, they're colorful, they're totally E for everybody. It was before the Super Soldier era of Metal Gear Solid kind of came out and started really some new darker trends in the industry that were more around military and violence and stuff, and shooters like Doom, and which was still very cartoony, like original Doom. If you go back and play it now, you're, you know, it's just a total cartoon. But there was a fascination with kind of a power fantasy that ended up driving a ton of business in the game industry. And I think that games that tend to focus on domination and power will end up affecting the culture that plays it, and affects the studios that build it too. Can't they have more of a tendency to do that? I don't have science to point to, so this is just me having a theory. So I have no science.
I asked for your personal opinion, not for the science.
Personal opinion, right? That said, I worked on a ton of shooters, and even the cultures I've been in, well, there is a lot more kind of, you know, I'd say there's a little more focus on who has the best skill at the end of the day in a multiplayer game to come out as the winner. Mm-hmm. It's still very much an experience that's based on winning. And the way you win is by dominating. Right? You mm-hmm. dominate the playground, and the playground happens to be, you know, jump, toss the grenade, you know, pistol whip, and then teabag. And that's the sequence in which you win. Right. So, you know, like, and so that's the game. And so you end up, you know, in those sorts of experiences, and they're more like maybe the Running Man. I don't know if you remember, like back in the day, there was like movies and books like the Running Man, which were violent game shows, you know. Mm-hmm. And that's kind of what a lot of the big business had turned into, because it was easy to pull from these film references. They're kind of creative petri dishes for the game. Yeah. Early development, right? And you could pull from Michael Bay movies and pull the formula out of a Michael Bay movie and stick it into a Medal of Honor or a Call of Duty game, almost like that's actually what the early Call of Duties and Medal of Honors were built on, was basically the framework of a Michael Bay movie. Cinematic moments was a big thing back then. Trying to recreate cinematic moments. Mm-hmm. And usually the cinematic moments were big action, you know, the money shots from big action movies. And recreating those scenes and wanting to, you know, live through those scenes. And a lot of that is all around an action movie. And so I think that reward structure contributes to a culture which is chasing an aspirational value. And that aspirational value is to win in a metaphorical, not a real fight, right? Not real, a video game version of a real fight, right? And so that's where I think, if I had to have a theory about it, that's my best guess right now.
So for me, that's the whole like toxic masculinity of war theory, right? That like we play video games in exactly what you're describing, like these really aggressive, usually with a male lead. You know, yeah. As far as I know, none of the Call of Duty, Medal of Honor, none of those franchises have a female option.
I'll give you and this would be a rare example, but the sequel to Medal of Honor stars a female lead in the French resistance. And there was a deliberate choice by the producer of the franchise at the time, the producers of the franchise at the time, to tell legitimate stories about, you know, because it was honestly, it was like taken from real life.
Right.
It might fictionalize a lot of elements, but the early Medal of Honors were very much history, like they're a honest history lesson, you know, and what happened in World War II. And I think, I don't know if it's still trying to do that, but, or it did in the recent editions, but in the early days, that's definitely was a big component.
So there is some, so already I'm wrong, but that is like, that's the
kind of exception, total exception.
Yeah.
Probably, right. Yeah.
And so, I mean, I definitely like that, again, that sort of hyper dramatization and, winning through toxic masculinity in a lot of ways, because it's, you know, glorifying all of like the things that make up toxic masculinity in a lot of ways, like, oh, you're shot, but you're still going, and like, no, you know, real men don't cry. And like that whole kind of ethos is really celebrated in those games, but those aren't the only games out there. And so like, I've had people question whether or not I can be a real gamer around shit like Skylanders, Dave. Skylanders.
Huh.
Like, I don't, it's like they think that because I have lady parts, I can't work an Xbox controller.
Yeah.
And very consistently, women I know who are gamers hear things like, oh, let me guess, Mario Kart. Am I right?
Yeah.
Because that's what you play with your girlfriend.
Got it.
Like, well, first of all, I haven't been anybody's girlfriend in a long time.
Yeah.
Second of all, I was gaming before that guy came around. So start there. And thirdly, I suck at Mario Kart and I hate its face. I like to watch other people play. I have no interest in playing Mario Kart myself.
Yeah.
Does not tick my boxes. So like, but I will say that we consistently, that is something that I know women hear
all the time.
A lot.
Yeah.
And
the best advice I could give, and I have three daughters, like 18, they're always changing. I have one son, so they're always changing birthdays. I'm going to get it wrong. 18, 14, and 13. Yeah, that's right. Again, we had them all at once pretty much. So 18, 14, and 13. My son's 16. My advice is you gotta go in with, I have, my son is a total gaming freak. My youngest daughter loves to play certain games. She loves racing and she loves Fortnite.
Okay.
So she loves to play those. Sega Sonic All-Stars. Sonic and Sega All-Stars Racing. And the sequel, I think, are her favorites. The kill, to me, it's all about planning the kill shot. So like the point is to go in and prove like that you don't, so that you don't have to go, you know, have to sit through a massive interrogation, right? It'd be all about we work on formulating a single statement so that when you walk into any room with, and you start to encounter this kind of stuff, there's, you could just say one thing and it just establishes your credibility and shuts everybody up.
I guess I just don't understand why I need credibility as a gamer. Like, it's a hobby, Dave. It's a hobby. When I am walking in to sell myself as a recruiter for a gaming studio, that is a different kind of credibility I need to
establish. Yeah, yeah.
You know what I mean?
Right, right.
That pitch I've got. But if I just want to walk into a GameStop
and
pick out a new video game, what I don't need is the spotty face kid behind the till being like, oh, are you here for something for your boyfriend?
Yeah.
No, because my husband gets mad when I buy him presents. Come on.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I feel like you're doing the hard work in breaking down, because the only way to change, I think, people's actual cognitive behavior, like the thinking patterns that they are going through when they seem to recognize an anomaly in their landscape, is to have it no longer be an anomaly.
Yeah.
Right. And so the more powerfully you can do that, the more that it will no longer be like a thing that they're going to do over and over again, you know?
I give myself license to be a bitch when it happens. Cause I'm like,
yeah. Well, and guys, so guys are trash talking each other all the time. So if you have somebody who sucks at games, like I tend to be, especially in the first person shooter titles I've worked on. And the guys from my teams would corroborate this, is that I tend to be in the bottom half of the skill ranks. Right. So I'm like the one that everyone's having to carry, maybe not all the time, but some of the time. And so I don't have a reputation of being first picked. Right. Mm-hmm. And so I'll get trash talked all the time too, but it's because I'm at a certain skill level and there isn't any association with gender or sex with me. But I still deal with it all the time. And I think any guy who is entering into a competitive space has to show where they rank in terms of a skill. And it's just, that's sort of a normal guy thing, you know, if it's sports or the trash talking in sports is normal, like trash talking in games is the same thing. Like it's this,
I'm here for trash talk. That doesn't bother me.
That's where you could totally own them.
Yeah.
Right?
I'm not very good at the games with the trash talk, Dave. I've got that one down.
That's where you win.
Yeah. Verbal manipulation. I'm much better than all the rest of them, but it is just the perception. So you mentioned there the sporting analogy.
Yeah.
And you've got kids that play games. Dude. So I've heard a number of podcasts and read a bunch of articles about making the case that video games are the new sport. And there are universities who are giving out scholarships for League of Legends and all that kind of stuff. Now, absolutely.
Scholarships? Okay.
Scholarships the same way they do for athletes. Like, I have recruited kids who literally were going to university on a League of Legends scholarship.
Wow. I had no idea.
The pools for these gaming cons are hundreds of thousands, if not millions of dollars to the victor. Like, virtual sport is huge. So as a dad, because my husband and I are having this debate ourselves. There are people now who hire professional gaming coaches for their children in the same way that if you had a kid who was a good basketball player and wanted to go to college on a basketball scholarship, be very normal to pay for some extra basketball coaching for that kid, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
They do the same thing with video games.
Wow.
And my husband and I are like, I'm just too old because I can't get my head around a world in which you not like where practicing your video game is a thing that your mother tells you you have to do, right? Like video games were what you got to do when you finished your homework and ate all your broccoli when I was a kid.
Yeah.
And instead, and like, you know, I was a competitive swimmer and diver. I was a softball player. And then I quit doing things that moved my body if I could possibly avoid it and became a debater. I know you're surprised to hear that one. But all of those things were things that I had to practice and I had coaches and all of that kind of stuff. I just can't get my head around that as a video game. What, as a dad, if your kids were like, Dad, I'm really good at Overwatch and I feel like I want to go for this scholarship for Overwatch and I how does that sit? How do you feel about that?
Man, it's my initial gut reaction is stop, don't, right? It doesn't make any sense. That's never going to work.
Yeah.
But quickly I have to arrest that because I recognize it as sort of a knee jerk reaction. And I have to think back to I got started in the game industry when it was tiny, you know, our teams were 10 people or 12 people, right? Like the whole team. and we never thought it was going to be, I can't speak for everybody that I've ever worked with, but if we had known, we had no idea it was going to blow up to be what it is. I mean, it was like this weird little niche thing that we thought was really cool. And we were the audience of the things we were making, right? I mean, it was, a totally like a weird little niche thing. It blew up into what it is today, kind of like anime is now, right? Mm-hmm. And my parents would have, if they had known in advance, you know, I went to two different colleges and ended up in video games, right? Like if they had known like that I was going to end up, they're going to spend all this money and I was going to end up being a video game artist, I don't know if they would have supported it. Would they have supported it? I don't know. But like, is it a thing? Well, it's been a thing so far for 20 something years. That's not true for everybody. Like, and so it's, so you can't, I can't know 100% that being an esports, you know, star is the way to go, but I would be concerned about a lot of, you know, as a dad, as a lame dad, I have to be concerned about things like, you know, people are using drugs to get an extra edge during gameplay, and they have to start to do testing and all of this BS, right? Like, there's skills that they're building which are not physical, right? Mm-hmm. I don't know how they map to anything else because I'm a lame old dad, right? But maybe there is a world in the future where they do. I have no idea.
But at the same time, like, I understand the case for you learn skills through sports. I'm a big believer that competitive sports, that everybody needs to do it because it teaches you how to lose. And it teaches you that when you're on a team with people and you don't pull your weight, that pisses people off.
It also gives you an idea of your strengths and where you can contribute the most and how you fit within a hierarchy and all kinds of good stuff.
Huge fan of competitive sports for young people. Struggle more with the video game, because like you said, like to me, the physical sport thing, like you're learning those lessons, great. After a while, you kind of learned as much of that lesson as you're going to get from the sports. Having a love of the sports encourages you to love doing things that move your body and keep you healthy for the rest of your life. Great. There's only so much of that you're going to do, right? Like once you get to that, I am training to be the next LeBron James, you're in this whole different world. And those skills that you're getting there that are going to make you the difference between the random kid playing high school basketball and the kid that's being picked to be the next LeBron aren't going to translate to anything but basketball. That is pure basketball.
Yeah.
So it's kind of, again, you wouldn't say no if your kid wanted to be a basketball star.
Right.
And that's what I keep coming back to is I'm like, damn it.
Oh, they need to
fall back. Them do that.
I would probably say, okay, we need to prove it. You're going to have to hit some pretty clear goals, right? You have to win this competition, win the next competition. We're going to go, I'll support it. But we're going to need a fallback strategy too, right?
Oh, for sure.
And we'll have to prove that we're paying attention in school and getting good grades.
Because all it takes is one torn ACL and then you ain't LeBron anymore. Absolutely. Absolutely.
That's right.
Yeah.
But ideally, I mean, if there's legitimate passion and excitement and resonance in somebody, whether that's my kids or whether that's somebody that I'm working with or that I'm supervising or anything, like that's energy. That's pure energy, right? Like it's coming naturally out of a well inside the person. And and to fight against it is you should only really do if you're certain or there's a large chance of doom, right? Or peril or something, right?
Exactly.
Otherwise, let them do it. They're gonna totally get so much value out of accomplishing what they're chasing that they can fold into their future plans. That it's more important to me that my kids realize these loops of being completely just obsessed with something and then going out and achieving and accomplishing something amazing and then folding that into whatever they're going to do after that.
You realize that now they're going to hear this and they're going to be like, Dad, I want to be like competitive Overwatch, you're in. So I'm going to need a lot of gaming time on my weekly schedule. And you're going to be like,
what did I do?
Michelle, I thought we were friends. You set me up. So along that note, I have this theory and I think you'll agree with me, but you may not. So I'm excited to hear that at the beginning of the 20th century, literacy rates we're not high in this country. And one of the major determining factors for a lot of skilled employment was literacy. Mm-hmm. And then over the course of the 20th century, we worked our way up to where we are now, which is like a 90% literacy rate. I believe, and I may be crazy, that in the 21st century, the same will be true for the ability to code. That at the beginning of the 21st century, the number of coders was this big, but that as we move through life, there are fewer and fewer jobs that don't require some ability to code. And so I think that as we move, like I said, we're going to need to like that for our kids, right? That in order for them to be competitive in the job market, and I don't care what they want to be, that they will need to be able to code at some level. You are more in the zone than I am. What do you think about that?
I can absolutely say, I mean, anybody I think in the industry, in the game industry could say that, I mean, if you can code, then you are bringing an extra, a new extra dimension to your skill set that sets you apart. I think it definitely, even to the limited, very limited degree that I can code, it set me apart and has helped me. Like I, like right before joining us here, I was in a 2-hour code, you know, code review session, and I could understand conceptually what was going on. I don't understand all the details, obviously, but conceptually I can understand it well enough to ask useful questions, right? In the meeting. And it, to be able to have that understanding is really good. If it's possible to teach from an early age, I know that there are many programs which teach visual scripting, and my kid did a, you know, Minecraft coding. My boy did a Minecraft coding camp, so that he can make a mod. I think I've tried to push some of that at my daughter's, and they're just like tissue rejection. They're just like not into it at all. And I have a wide, my three daughters have very different personalities. One's very tomboy. It's a gymnast. She's the one that loves to play video games. She's full of energy any minute of the day, or the middle of the night, she'll be up, you know? And then I have the other two lean like across the spectrum, you know? I forget where I was going with that.
What was but your not, sorry? It was, but you were talking about they're not as interested in coding, that your they're son not as interested has,
in coding, right? Yeah. So, but you're, I think you were right in terms of people that can, and at least can conceptually understand coding, have gone through, say, a 1 or 2 year computer science course in school, will have a language. It's like learning a language. It's literally like, you know, English, you're born learning American English. If you learn Spanish, then you'll be more diverse, right?
Spanish was actually my first language, but yes, you're right.
Oh, there you go. So Spanish and then English, then you're more diverse. It's learning another language, and coding is a language. And a lot of the concepts in coding span different varieties of languages, you know, like for loops or whatever. But understanding the basic syntax of coding will arm anybody with another language. And that language is has high utility today and in the future. So very much it's important to the people that, I feel like there are some people that are just, they're still illiterate. They don't even know how to copy paste. Some people don't even know how to copy paste still, you know?
Yeah.
I don't know what to do for those people. Don't know what to do. Like, it's not like there isn't, it's not easy, or the concept isn't everywhere. It's on every platform, copy paste. Everybody knows, everybody can copy paste.
So there's tons of studies out there about the difference in terms of what is obvious for those of us that have had technology either for our entire life or for most of our life within memory, right? Like, I'm right on the cusp of that. Am I millennial? Am I Gen X? One of those geriatric millennials, that's very flattering, but I like that kind of that zone, right? So I remember the first Tandy computer that my family got, and then we got an 8088, and like, I remember we played NetHack, right? Like, I, all of that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
NetHack was awesome. Yeah. But like, I remember that, but it was very young. And so I have kind of grown up with technology and computers being de rigueur.
Yeah.
Whereas for folks that did not grow up with that, it's a very, like, for me, computers are obvious. Like, I don't need you to tell me where I'm going to find a such and so file, because it's obviously, yeah, like there's an innate
you have kind high of, literacy. Yeah, you have high literacy. Yeah.
But for people who didn't grow up like that, I have to check myself sometimes that, you know, either because of a generational issue or a geographic issue, like they were in a part of the world that didn't have access to computers in their home, or for a socioeconomic reason, you know, there's a thousand reasons people don't grow up with the technology, but it does really, really, really skew as an adult how obvious this stuff is to people. So I think, for me, I think that that's kind of a big part of that. Like, what do you mean you can't copy paste? Because when when we grew up with it, it's different that way.
It is. Well, and cell phones are changing so much. Just anecdotally, I work with a charity that helps third world countries, and the people that we talk to that live there, they all have phones. They all have Android phones. Pretty much Android phones, right? Mm-hmm. So I'm chatting with these folks all day long, but they understand copy paste, right? Yeah. They've got copy paste. They don't because they now have access to copy paste and the power of being able to use a phone.
Right.
A lot of it's because that's their wallet too, you know. And so that's their financial literacy. That's how they learn about everything in the world through the internet. That's how they talk to other people in other areas, whether they have reliable electricity or not, you know, their phone is going to be charged to the degree that they can help it, right? Because that's the essential tool that they own.
It's a light source. It's a communication source. It's an emergency, like all of that. Absolutely.
All those things. So the world is going to see in the next generation something that we couldn't even have conceived of in like the 90s or the 80s, right?
Let alone before that. Yeah.
I'm 46, so I grew up, my dad was a lifelong IBM employee, technical sales. So I had an 8086, the first, you know, with a 10 meg hard drive, like that was me, right? CGA monitor. So I grew up around, you know, new units from IBM, basically. And I learned to code in BASIC when I was 7, right? Because of that. And I was like writing songs, basically. I was using the, you know, the speaker and the computer to write music. Nice. But if you're around it, you'll learn it, right? I mean, if it's a key part of your life, and it is for the, like the whole world now, even for the poorest people, they're going to find a way to get an Android phone because they're so powerful. So the entire world is going to change over the next generation because the billions and billions of people all over the world have been growing up with the internet for the first time.
And have a voice.
Yeah.
On a global scale that was never the case before.
Right. So. And it's centralized, and there's the gatekeepers are getting, you know, basically as much as we're seeing a tug of war right now between gatekeepers and decentralized solutions. I think it's heading in a decentralized direction. For every time that we see an attempt to control technology, there's more pressure to develop decentralized solutions. And it's just,
blockchain.
Happen. Yeah, blockchain's amazing. So.
Yeah. So we're almost out of time. So I do have one more question that I want to ask, because I get asked this all the time and I give my answer. But I don't have your street cred for the answer. So, and I may learn something as well. So when you came into gaming, because you were smart and creative and made a game, and somebody was like, holy crap, this guy knows how to make a video game. We should hire him. DreamWorks, come on down. These days, there's a lot more candidates in the gaming market. And it is when I started recruitment for gaming, nobody gave a shit about resumes. None of my clients gave a shit about if they'd gone to college. All they wanted to see was a portfolio.
Yeah.
You tell me you're a gaming engineer. Great. Show me some of your senior that you've done. Show me, like, that's what they wanted was the portfolio. And that was it.
Mm-hmm.
These days, when I work with gaming companies, all they want to see is a resume. And then if they're interested enough at the resume and at the interview, like usually preparing for the interview, that's when they look at the portfolio. Like it's there.
Yeah.
But that may be my sample set of this, right? So what would be your advice? Like, do you think that a portfolio is still ultimately, like if you want to be in gaming, the portfolio is the way to go, is to spend your time building that? Do you think that it's about getting a fancy degree? Do you think there's a magical qualification that will suddenly make every gaming studio be like, oh my God, I must have him on my staff now? Or what's your advice for people wanting to get into gaming?
Well, so I got to caveat a little bit in, I've done a ton of hiring, but I'm also 46. And so the way that I hire is going to be baked into when I started, right? Mm-hmm. So people that are 25, that are maybe seniors or leads now may have a different philosophy. I don't know. So I'll say that just to get it out of the way.
Okay.
But, to me, it's interesting that you'd say that people don't look at portfolio. To me, like that's how I grew up, right? We'd look at portfolio. So mm-hmm. I care about portfolios. I mean, portfolios matter way more than anything else because they tell you whether somebody paid attention in school or not, or you know how good their instructors were, how ambitious they are, how complex have they, how high have they reached on their own, and it helps you assess their long-term potential just from looking at the portfolio, right? And you can do all that just by looking at the portfolio. I wonder if some of it is a byproduct of game developers used to be small and now they're huge. And that means that they come with a full-featured recruiting team, HR group, and a bunch of other people that end up being the initial screeners.
Mm-hmm.
And the initial screeners don't know, I work with many that don't know how to look at a portfolio or assess it. And it, and that's awesome, right? Like, and some are open and they want to learn like how, and so I've worked with those, with people like that in the past, and it can point out some basic things to look for and how to examine composition or how to look at lighting or, look at proportion, like basics. Right. And so I wonder if some of the emphasis is now on recruiting departments and their intake systems, mm-hmm. where they can parse a resume and put it into their like lever or whatever their system is, right, for intake. And it works with the computer system for the applicant process. I taught a class at Otis, it was their first gaming class in Los Angeles. And one of the lessons I did was all around how to hack the front door, meaning the recruiting front door. Mm-hmm. A lot of the things that I taught the class then were around how to get around the gatekeeping. And so that's what I would recommend is
circumvent us entirely.
The front door is like the hardest filter, right? And it's the most brutal that you're going to go through. And we went through a mock portfolio review in the class and what it was like to actually sit through one. So that they could understand how their work was going to be looked at, how the environment in which their work would be looked at. And it helped. I think it helped. I got feedback and from my class and many who went on to be in the game industry said that it helped as well. Yeah. Because it basically is like, look, don't waste your time with this, this, and that. Instead, focus on this other thing and you'll be way more effective, right? So I think end running, finding ways to be visible to people is a great way to expose yourself to hiring managers. Now, the hiring managers are the key people, right? Like if you're an artist looking to get hired, you want the hiring manager to see your portfolio. So I would say that I'm not if I'm hiring for a position, I honestly don't really care about which school they came from, unless it's just from a kind of like a handful of, a very small handful of schools. Like, because the schools tend to not matter, that the departments are kind of generic. They're kind of structured based off of more obvious lessons that you can kind of learn online for free if you want. I mean, there's really not a massive reason to go get a gaming degree somewhere unless it's from just a handful of schools that are actually really good at it. And so I would not recommend, that's me being 46 and my style, I would not recommend emphasizing the degree or the school as being the way in. I would focus on the quality of your work and show it. I know there's a ton of people and they're all just, the trick isn't to run out and do a few lessons on YouTube for how to, you know, build something in Unity, you know, necessarily. It's to have a creative vision around what you want to make first. And you could make that vision in any way, like in almost any way first before you have to make it as a video game, I'd say.
I think one of the things I get frustrated when people come to me for this advice is I'm like, look, you have to have a good resume to get in front of the hiring manager. Because you're right. Like the recruiters, the sourcers, the HR, the whoever, all they're going to do is look at that piece of paper. I think that that's a terrible measure personally, but that's what they're going to do. But then after that, the hiring manager is really just going to go look at your portfolio. That's really all they give a shit about.
Mm-hmm.
You have to tick the boxes to get to them. But then after that, they want to look at the portfolio. And what I hear a lot from people is, well, how do I do a portfolio? Will you make a website a thousand like portfolio websites you can go to. GitHub has great portfolio stuff. Like there's tons of other ones as well. DeviantArt, like whatever, right? Like,
yeah, that's right.
And make a portfolio and then have that link on every freaking thing ever.
Mm-hmm.
And hope that somebody clicks on it and they're like, oh, well, that's a lot of work. I
don't, like, this is your career, right? Yeah. Like
you want this job or not? Like ultimately. Right. And again, pushback.
I would just say put it on ArtStation, right? I think it's free to put on ArtStation. ArtStation is a super common destination.
I always like DeviantArt because it's darker stuff. And like, that's just my personal style. Do you know what I mean?
DeviantArt's cool. Yeah, DeviantArt's cool.
Yes, ArtStation is fine too. Yeah. So, but yeah, that's what I hear when I give that is that you can't pick and choose anymore, because most of the hiring managers I know in gaming are like, if you tell people that I'm the freaking hiring manager for this, I'm coming at you. I will find where you live.
Yeah.
And I will hunt you down because my inbox does not need 9,000 wannabe game developers emailing me, begging me for a job. Yeah. That's why I'm paying you. So, and I feel that, but like, ultimately, like I said, almost everybody is just going to look straight at the resume. Personally, all I do is click on their portfolio. If they don't have a portfolio, my answer is no. Like, there's too many people that have one.
That's what, when I get an art candidate, if I don't have a portfolio link, it's an instant no. Actually, it's not an instant no. It's an instant me pushing back to the recruiter to say, where is the link to the portfolio?
Did you not do your job here?
Because without that, I mean, like, I don't even care. Like, it got to the point where I was going through so many, like, I can't even look at their name, right? Mm-hmm. Like, I look at their portfolio and then I remember the person because of a piece or a couple of pieces in the portfolio. And I go, oh, you're Moses or you're Jose or you're Jessica or whatever. And then I can associate the person with their name, with their pieces. And then I go to their resume and say, okay, how many other developers have you looked at or worked at? Environments, right?
The way that I work with hiring managers in gaming is I tend to just send them the link to the portfolio. And then if you click on that and you like it, then I'm happy to give you the rest of their detail. You don't need to know anything else.
Honestly, I don't even need to know their name or anything.
Yep.
Absolutely.
That's my take on it. Like you get one email from me with like, hey Dave, I think this person would be great for a blah project, because usually, you know, a couple of different projects. Like, I think this person would be great for this role. have a look. Let me know what you think. Click on the portfolio, yay or nay. Great. If it's a yes, here is then my notes about them as a candidate, and here's their resume, because that's the first time you care. But yeah, that's, I prefer just to start with the portfolio because I don't want to cloud it with anything else.
Yeah.
Ultimately. Yeah. And it's a pain in my ass to type up those long emails. It's way easier to just be like this. No. Okay. Cool.
And that especially works for artists, obviously. For design, it definitely shows a willingness to go above and beyond if they produce a portfolio or a website or anything that shows their work. That's great. That is less common, though, I have to say, for design. See,
again, I even tell the design people, you need it. Like, it's a competitive industry. If you want to work in the competitive industry, you got to show up all day.
Definitely will help. I mean, and engineers are unique too, right?
But they can have portfolios who there is not. In like 2021, there is no excuse. If you want to work in something like gaming, like, and for obviously engineers, those kind of guys, I don't just send their portfolio. Like, I send the other stuff, but I think that it helps. Like, if I can say, here's a link to their GitHub, here's some code that you can see that they've done, 100%. Here's some pieces, like, here's some games that they've worked on. This is the functionality piece that they created there. Like, that's what you care about. And if people are like, oh, well, but I haven't worked on any games. Well, then make one. There's 9,000 free tools out there. Hell, I told you my husband's making one for my kids in his free time. Like, you don't have to be, it doesn't have to cost you anything. And you don't have to like already be in being paid to do it. And if you're not willing to cut your teeth on some free products, then why should somebody pay you to cut your teeth on their product that's going to keep the lights on?
That's right.
Kind of my take on it.
Yep. I totally agree.
I have used up all of your time and then some. So we not talked about that you wanted to cover?
Well, this is my first podcast, so I didn't come with any preconceived ideas. So I'm so excited. I don't have anything.
I'm honored at all the levels. Oh my gosh. I get to be your first podcast. That is exciting.
It's been great though. Thank you.
I think this has been fantastic and super informative. I think one of my favorite things is just your humility that it took me, first 10 minutes to get you to like say the name Call of Duty Medal of Honor. All of the things that like people will be like, oh my God, that guy. So it always makes me happy talking to you, if only for those reasons, Dave. You're a delight. Thank you so much for being with me.
Yeah, you bet. Anytime.
All right. Thanks, Dave.
Thank you.
You've been listening to Hey, I Want Your Job. For more information on how you can get your own awesome job, visit ONH Consulting at www.onhconsulting.com. We offer incredible resumes, no-nonsense career advice, and real-world tips for landing a job in today's market. Check us out on LinkedIn, Twitter, Facebook, and Insta for more insider information. Soon, you'll be hearing us say, I'm Michelle Olivier, and hey, I want your job.